Good evening and welcome everybody to another interesting and insightful session with CCOF. Today we are getting into the details, like the title suggests. It's the devil is in the details, right? And with so much of data going around in the market today, and businesses use these data to make data-driven decisions to, you know, satisfy their customers or whatever it may be, data becomes a very crucial point. And where do you look? And that's primarily what we're going to talk about today and more, of course. I'd like to welcome our speaker for the day, Pankaj Rai. He's the Group Chief Data and Analytics Officer at Aditya Birla Group. He's a well-known expert in analytics and banking and has over more than two decades of experience in the financial services industry, subsequently in the offshoring space as well. In his previous stint at Wells Fargo, he successfully established digital capabilities to enable Wells Fargo's channels drive global programs. Prior to Wells Fargo, he was with Dell, where he led a team of business research, data analysis, and statistic modeling, spanning domains like marketing, strategy, pricing, online supply chain, and financial services. He's always been in financial services, and through his career, he's been in companies like ICICI and GE Capital. Prior to which, he had a program management position with Standard Chartered Bank in the Singapore regional office, where he helped grow their shared services center located in India and Malaysia. He is an alum of the IIT Delhi and IIM Ahmedabad, and he is the only Six Sigma quality leader from GE. Welcome, Pankaj, to the session. Along with him, of course, we have our moderator for the day, MD. Who is fondly known as. He's an alum of IIT Madras, Michigan State University, and Stanford Business School, and he's been an industry veteran for 32 years and an entrepreneur for the last 18 years. And he was the first managing director of Dell in India and one of the pioneers of the contact center industry in the country today. Currently, he's a mentor to many startups and a passionate customer service, customer experience advocate. With that, I hand it over to you, MD. Over to you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Renil. And Pankaj, welcome. It's been a while. You know, we keep meeting each other where on either Ring Road or Cobbett Park. But it's wonderful to see you in our CCOF webinar. So welcome. I'm going to get started with using Renil's introduction itself. IIT Delhi, IIM Ahmedabad, banks, financial services, stint in Dell. And how did you end up in data science?
So thanks, Vandi, and great to see you all. You know, we are all in a different attire than we normally see ourselves in Cobbett Park. And so it's good to be in these formal attires. I have been longing to go back to wearing a blue shirt or a white shirt, which I have been doing since I joined my current job. But for the last year and a half, you know, I was just roaming around mostly in t-shirts. And for this job, I actually had to go and buy a slightly larger size waist pants, because I did not fit into the older ones, and I have to now work on it and can get back in. But anyway, so thanks for asking that question. And I think this is a common question a lot of people ask these days, you know, career path and, you know, how did you decide to do what you did and what can I do and all of that. So in my case, it was quite simple. I didn't have any specific idea on what I wanted to do. So I always went with the flow. So the engineering happened because my dad felt that I should go to IIT because he had gone to IIT and he kind of made sure that I went there. It wasn't left to me and he met his objective. And after that, you know, I realized that, you know, doing masters and all will be hard because I started writing SOPs, which is statement of purpose. And then I realized I had no purpose doing the bachelor's itself. So I left it. And then, you know, what happened in those days, if you didn't do that, then the other option was MBA. And since I had no clue about the MBA, so there was no love or hate, because for engineering, there has developed some kind of a distaste, if I can say so, or it wasn't meant for me. So I went for the MBA, got that and went with the flow. And after that, you know how it is. Life is campus. You know, you go to placement, you get a job. And then after that, every other job after that was a friend of mine in the future company who said, you know what, I think this will be a better place for you. Why don't you come over? And all my jobs have been based on a friend recommending that place. And I'm saying, okay, looks like they know me well. And if they're saying so, it should be okay. And it's worked out well so far. So there was no idea of being a data science person or a banking person or a Six Sigma person or any of that sort. All of that were a result of some friends or seniors telling me that this is what I should do, and I just accepted their advice. And since I didn't have any better idea, it worked out well for me.
That is an amazingly candid answer. You just ended up there.
Yeah. And this job is no exception. So yeah, I thought, this is a great group and a lot of diversity. Some friends were there and they recommended, my predecessor himself recommended. And I said, okay, if he's saying so and he liked it, then should work out well for me. So yeah, so far so good.
The good thing is, because you've ended up there, I suppose you'll get to know a lot more because you kind of went in with an open mind.
Which
brings me to I think it's an important kind of decluttering question. Just on terminology which get used, I'm sure our members will really look forward to this answer. What is data science, data analytics? What's the difference? When do you use what?
Yeah. So, I have somehow stayed away from adjectives because I never stayed in any domain for too long to fall in love with any of them. So I think whether it is digital or, .com or .net or all kinds of things, I don't know. I think maybe the consulting firms create those names because it's easier to position those products well. So in my mind, I have never looked at data science or analytics or digital as any different from a means to an end. And the end has always been making an impact on the business. So when people also, these days the most, often asked question is that, I want to get into data science and what will my career be and all of that. My usual answer is that if you look at any, these techniques or tools that we use, they tend to become obsolete at some point in time or the other. And the rate of obsolescence has only increased. So I was a Six Sigma guy once upon a time in G&G, was very famous for Six Sigma. But many people who stayed longer than the shelf life of that Six Sigma era, I think found them on the wrong side. So I was actually somehow was able to get away from that, use that experience and then move on and do other business roles. And I think the same thing I think about data science or data analytics or whatever you call it, because end of the day, you are using a tool or a technique to impact the business. As long as you can impact the business, you are relevant. So I always say that the business impact role will never disappear. It'll always be in demand. But every other role will have a shelf life. So keep an eye on how you are creating an impact. And, just continue to learn new things. But don't get bogged down by an adjective. Because if someone was bogged down by being a Six Sigma expert, they could never retire as that. And I don't know whether every data scientist, maybe some, will ever retire as a data scientist. So my own view is that that's a good place to be in, whatever you call yourself. But are you making an impact? And therefore, the goal for my team and whenever I have been in the data science or data analytics field has been, what are we trying to achieve? How are we impacting business? And the root seems to be what you may call data science or digital or data analytics or BI or whatever that may be. And yeah, I can have some definition of each of those things. But to me, it doesn't really matter. It's the idea that, you are utilizing data in some form, which in the past was not easily available, tools were not easily available. So it has become, a big deal. In fact, I also remember my GE days when we used to use the DMAIC methodology for process improvement. It used to be define, measure, analyze, improve, control. And I was saying, hey, that A within DMAIC used to be actually analysis, and we used to do some analysis, mostly in Excel, maybe not in SQL, but now with the more powerful tools. But end of the day, we were trying to improve a process. So even today, you are trying to make an impact. So net focusing on the impact. And my favorite this thing is that if mental math can solve it, don't use a calculator. If the calculator can solve it, don't use a SQL query. And the SQL query can solve it, don't use neural networks. So I think we don't need to go toward complex solutions if a simpler, easier solution can do it. But many a time, as you and I have both seen, that if we get educated on something, we have this love for using it. Because I have a car, I'll keep driving around. Because I have learned maths, I'll utilize maths to solve all problems in the world and all of that.
Right.
I think we need to just look at all our knowledge as a sunk cost. And then, as they say in the lean world, that you pull whatever is relevant. And if frankly, nothing is relevant, then go acquire new knowledge.
I completely understand. Because there was a time when everybody's resume used to have the Six Sigma in bold, right?
Yeah. I had that as well.
What you're pointing out is the outcomes, which, whatever methodology you use, the outcome is the more important thing. Now, talking about outcomes, Pankaj, how is that kind of driven? In other words, let me try and ask this question right. Do I go looking for a problem and using the problem and then looking at data? Or do I just see data and say, hey, this data, something is jumping out of it, and here is a problem? How does one go about it? What comes first, chicken or egg?
That's a very good question. So, Sandy, what has happened is there are a set of problems that we all as business leaders have been solving. And I think sometimes utilizing data, you can solve a new set of problems which you never thought were worth solving or could be solvable because that data wasn't available. So I would say both. So clearly we have to start from outside in to say, okay, you have to increase revenue, reduce cost, all of those types of things and see what you can do to do it. But many a times, just because you have all kinds of data available, you can create some interesting insights which were not possible. Those insights can lead to certain actions which were again not possible. And the easiest way to understand that is the whole digital online world. You know, Netflix or Amazon telling you what to buy next. It's so simple. But if you were thinking of your business in the old-fashioned way, this idea that this is something worth solving would not even arise. So therefore, I think when we start to reimagine our business, especially in the digital world, in the new world, I think there are newer aspects of business, newer facets of business that can be brought to light or be solved in a different way, which was not possible. Just like even your call centers, you know, today, as you know, there are enough tools available which can in real time tell you a few things and make you do certain things which you would have otherwise not thought possible. So I do think that there is an augmentation of the old world in this call center story, or there are totally new things of next best purchase or, you know, how do you mass personalize things and so on. And therefore, both need to be looked at.
Interesting. So this, as you know, is a forum of CCOs, chief customer officers, which means they're basically run teams which are customer facing. It could be sales, it could be service, it could be tech support and so on. So that's really the, you know, group of people here. And so if you were to look at a CCO, let's say in a kind of a newish company or thinking about setting up a kind of data analytics, data science, whatever that function is, how would one think about it? Set up a kind of a team which helps all other teams, or kind of bring in some kind of data skills amongst the current management, current operational management? How does one think about that?
Yeah. So, MD, I think just like I said, the data science and some of these terminologies or taxonomies I find muddied. I think the CCO or the CXO terminologies are equally muddied, if not more, because again, it depends on the context. So, for example, let's take Microsoft or some of these, you know, big tech companies. They create a lot of products. Now, they have, you know, customer success officers whose job is to drive consumption. Now, that job never existed. You know, so now that you have a subscription model, you want to make sure that people are driving consumption. That wasn't required earlier. In fact, earlier you would, you know, pay by as you go. So I think newer types of roles and nomenclatures are coming. I think, you know, today, if actually I declutter the roles into just two. See, right now you can find 500 roles. Earlier there were maybe 50. I think actually there are just two. And the way I look at it is that in this digital world, you are either someone who's close to the customer or you are someone who's close to the technology. Because that's all there is to it. So if you are an Amazon or a new age company, those are the two things that you need to know, that, you know, what is the customer that you are going after? What do they want? And, you know, understanding or appreciating the customer need and things like that. And then the technology to deliver it in the best possible way. And usually most people will not be both. It will be superhuman to have both, you know, the skill set required to both sides. So I always, you know, advise folks that try to over time figure out what you might be good at. For example, I'm very clear. I can tell you the test that I did on myself, and other people can try it, that when I was in Dell, I felt that, oh, you know, this field is becoming very, you know, tech centric and AI focused and all that. And there's Andrew Ng, whose machine learning course has been done by 2 million people. And if I am an IT engineer, I can do it as well. And I said, okay, I will also enroll. I enrolled in Coursera. After an hour, I realized that I had no skill set, you know, available to do that course, nor actually the desire to also pursue that. You know, it's not as if, you know, sometimes as we say, if you have the desire, you can bring it up. So I kind of stayed away and I said, you know, I'll probably be more closer to the business and the customer and those side. And I will complement myself with folks who have that technical expertise and enthusiasm. So to me, I think, you know, we have to, and it's not so hard to figure out which side are you on. And then, you know, those roles and responsibilities are just nomenclature. You can be a CCO who's, you know, very technical, perhaps, but you are surrounded yourself, rest of the people who have more customer, this thing, or the other way around. So I don't think the role itself, you know, defines it. I have seen my peers highly technical, who have risen from the rank, they can do programming. I can do nothing. I can't even remember Fortran and BASIC that I learned in college. So I think that, you know, over time we have to figure out what we are good at, what we can do well. And then today everything is an ecosystem. You can never do anything alone, whether it is a business issue or a social issue or any issue. Then surround, get the other stuff around you so that together you can succeed.
Yeah, but that kind of makes sense in a more tech company, I guess. What about traditional companies like banks and, you know, retail? I mean, I know you're part of that as well now. So how does it work there? I mean, how different is it?
Depending on who you ask, they will always say that every company is a tech company these days. So surely the retail and finance people will certainly say that. I don't know, maybe the cement and the aluminium people may not say that yet. So you're absolutely right. There'll be some businesses which are far more tech / digital heavy, if you were to use this terminology, and therefore the answers will be different. So, you know, if I look at the portfolio which has more manufacturing, you know, take, you know, paints or, you know, any of those things, so they are still largely driven through a offline channel. You know, your distributors, stockists, all that, the whole FMCG world still hasn't gone online. But I think if you look at all of these companies, everyone, you know, seems to be interested in getting to the end customer. Even in our company where we have cement and aluminium, the traditional people never thought of the end customer. They were like pushing commodity through the system, which will go to the end customer. But today there are several initiatives in our company. And I know, you know, even in Asian Paints on the paint side and all of that, everyone is trying to have one leg into the customer directly, which may be a small leg today. So either launching a consumer product so that you come to them directly and things like that. So I think everyone is trying to become a consumer company. I remember when I was in Dell, we used to use this term, consumerization of IT. So even the, you know, the tech companies, if you're doing infrastructure work, and, you know, Dell was doing one of those things, but, you know, end of the day, every person is a consumer also. So you have to think like a consumer all the time. So I'm seeing that, you know, in general, the trend, even in enterprise companies, is to look at your customer's customer and trying to imagine how it will be eventually consumed. And therefore that consumer mindset is, you know, creeping into even what you would call enterprise company. I mean, that's a broad trend. I mean, I could be wrong. Maybe there are areas where this doesn't apply, but in general, at least in our group, the consumer focus is becoming higher and higher, even in traditional, you know, industries. And therefore, whenever you start thinking consumer, you have to start thinking digital and app and all of those types of things, because today's consumer is not going to engage with you in any other way when other people are going to give them a super app and all of that. So you can't stay behind. And therefore, I think that whole principle that we spoke about starts to apply at least in that area, which may be a small area, but a rapidly growing area, in my opinion.
Yeah. And as soon as you have the app, of course, there's enough data coming to you, and, you know, the you know, you move with that. So again, coming back to, analyst kind of a role, how does one set goals, KPIs, whatever? I know you said that there is customer facing and there is, you know, kind of tech facing, outward facing and inward facing roles. But if you really look at an analyst, and large companies have analyst teams and all, where do KPIs come in? And how does one measure it?
Yeah. So I think, I mean, I can give you examples of the, you know, team that I have been part of and what kind of, you know, KPIs, you know, we have set up. So end of the day, the ultimate KPIs are the business KPIs only, because end of the day, you are one other enabler who's helping them meet their objectives. And you can probably add a few new objectives that they hadn't thought of. And you say, you know what, we could actually do this also, which is probably not part of your KPI, but it's possible through data, all that. So, but the KPI has to be owned and, you know, believed by the business. But there could be other, you know, interim KPIs or ideas that you can do. So many a time, you know, these roles, and, you know, I have seen, been done in some outside of that core function, you know. So when I was in Dell, we had a centralized type of a team. Today here also we have a centralized type of a team. So I think the thinking that, you know, I have always had, that these teams have to act as a coach to help the business, you know, become more self-sufficient from the inside. You know, you can't be just telling them and answering questions or whatever. You can do that. So it's almost like a coach who's playing with you, but with the view that you can start playing, and one day I can withdraw and go coach someone else. So I think that thought process and that approach is very critical, because you have to make that business analytical and digital and all of those nice things from the inside. And that can't be done from the outside. No different from how the Six Sigma piece, you can say, happened, because you came from outside, then you developed the Six Sigma muscle inside. Either you yourself went in there, or you coached them and they became that, or they absorbed it in some way, you trained them or whatever, and then you kind of walked away and things like that. So I think every new capability, in my opinion, sometimes starts outside as a COE, because it's specialized and no one understands it, and there's someone think that this is important, and over time it has to be absorbed inside the business. But many a time what tends to happen is some of the leaders who might be leading that capability might just fall in love with that and may not want to give away the baby for adoption inside. So I think that is something that we need to all guard against, because the role of any central team is that of a coach, of making sure that osmosis happens and those muscles get strong faster. And sometimes, you know, some people have also asked, oh, so but if we coach them really fast, what will we do after that?
Yeah, exactly.
Be unemployed or whatever, right? And I think that was probably a right question. Let's say if you were asking that in the Six Sigma days, I would have, yeah, but you know, you don't want to retire a Sigma guy. You also find a role in the business and become a business guy and don't remain a Six Sigma guy. Now that answer, I think, is a different answer today in the digital world, because the digital world is evolving so fast that I told my team that, you know, whatever we know today, whether it in terms of a solution or a product or our own knowledge or our own capability, if we were to transfer everything to the business in the next 3 to 5 years, don't you think there's enough more that is there that we can go after? We are not talking about blockchain today. We aren't talking about quantum today. There are other things which are getting invented on a daily basis. So don't you think it is exciting that we transfer all our knowledge in a BOT model to someone else and then go invent something else? Because I think the fascinating thing in digital is that you can never think that you can become obsolete. In fact, you should be enthusiastic about transferring that knowledge, that you can become even more relevant by bringing in educating yourself on newer technology. So that's, I think, what I have learned over the years, MD.
That is a fascinating way of looking at it, by the way. I mean, so you don't build really silos around yourself, but keep transferring this knowledge, which actually comes to, you're transferring skills. So are there some basic attributes one needs to have within the business to absorb these kind of skills? I know this is like going back once upon a time, typing wasn't important, but today typing is so important. I mean, you need to type at a certain speed to actually, do your daily thing. So, skills are also going up. For example, does that mean everybody in the business needs to know some basics of Excel, perhaps? Or, how would you kind of push the envelope on that front within the business?
Sure. And there are three vectors, MD, that we can work on in doing this. So one is, like you rightly said, that there are some simple solutions that you can create, and our teams could do that using Excel or SQL or whatever, some queries. And then just like the Six Sigma world, you could train some of those people. Hey, Excel is not so hard. We can train you, or we can train one of your people. Or frankly, we can hire someone for you to have that. If you don't want to hire, we can hire a contractor for you to do that or whatever. So you can, build that capability within of that solutioning or whatever that skill set is. That's number one, by training people or getting them the right people to do that. The second is through products, to say, okay, while we did this, now we have productized it. You now have to just click and do things. This forecasting model will work on its own. You don't have to worry about the algorithm. It's all programmed. It will work. But you have to do a few things. Just like, think about it, you run the macro. You don't have to make the macro. Yeah. We have done the macro for you. I'm just using simple term that some of us in our we are used to. So that's the other thing, that you productize it and push it out to them and say, you can just use it on your own and you don't have to go under the hood and think about it. Periodically, we'll come and update it or make the algorithm better, or if it is an AI algorithm, it can work on its own and stuff like that. Third is through importing and exporting of people, that our people over time will have a career path in your team. And by the way, the smart people in your people who want to learn some of these things, get them over, let them come here. Or there could be short-term assignment that as a part of our BOT, while we created the solution for you, now our people will actually sit with you, work with you, make it run for you so that you can take over, you can understand, you can keep the people, or you can send them back after 3 months, 6 months or whatever. So I think these are the various vectors, MD, that can be utilized by people depending on the context in transferring that knowledge quickly.
Oh, fascinating. Actually, I just want to make a quick announcement to those watching this. You can post your questions, by the way, for Pankaj. You post them in the Q&A box, not in the chat box, but Q&A box. I'm kind of taking a look at it right now. Once the questions come up over there, I'll ask Pankaj your questions as well. that's fantastic, Pankaj. I mean, in terms of how you transfer it and transfer through small applications as well.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, what about the thinking part of it? Let me try to create an example. I'll give you a call center example. So let's say, you know, somebody, you know, an operation is having a high attrition. Okay. The problem statement is that, hey, my attrition is running berserk. So when you kind of look under the hood, you find out that most people are stretched, which means they are really understaffed. They are stretched and they are working 10, 12 hours a day, resulting in burnout. Therefore, people are not showing up and attrition and all that stuff. So there are multiple solutions possible. You know, one can say, hey, just go hire 15 more people. That will help. Or you can say the other extreme solution, saying that, you know what, reduce the time of working, transfer the problem to the customers, because customers will then have to wait a longer time in queues. Or the third kind of out of the box, more strategic solution could be, hey, you know what, you're getting, you know, let's say 100 queries a day. How about you thinking of reducing that to 50 queries a day? And we are talking about post sales, which means that I'm now saying that, you know, here are a whole bunch of queries which can be maybe eliminated because they're all related to problems in your product, or some of these can be driven to the IVR or self-help. Now, that thought could well come from an analyst team. Okay, so one is very short-term, quick, tactical thing. Other could be long-term. Do you see kind of centralized kind of data science teams playing that role of actually going the thinking out of the box and coming up with solutions of this kind?
Yeah. So I think, you know, at least in our case, because we are a group function or a central function who's not doing the run the business type of work, I would say we have the luxury right now to focus only on the longer term or specific business problem and not helping run the business. Because what tends to happen is, if you are an internal team, many a time your effort is in firefighting and you're just trying to make sure what happened today, what happened yesterday, all of that, and the longer term problem gets in. So that's a structural issue on how do you, you know, shrink wrap that team to be able to also think long term. But let's assume, you know, if you had this luxury, how do you do that? I think, you know, what I have always looked at my team is to say, you know, your main job, or at least at the more senior level, is to help define the right problem and not solving it, because the solution can actually, so in my personal opinion, again, I think the solution space of almost anything which is there is getting more and more commoditized. You know, if you look at data science, there's a website called Kaggle, which has competition where people can post problems and, you know, others can solve it. So I keep giving this, you know, humorous example to my people that, you know, any problem that the business have, I can maybe post it on Kaggle, and some Hungarian or Polish scientist in his free time can just solve it for free. So why do I need you? Because, you know, they're doing it free and maybe have a better solution. So that is more on a humorous side. But I think the main thing is, but what is the problem which is worth solving? Is where I think you can play a role that the Kaggle, you know, problem solver will not know. And that's where I think the competitive advantage is. And how do you develop that? I think a few different things which I think we need to realize is that, you know, first of all, that critical thinking, which is not new. I think all of us have realized that our system of rote learning and answering questions has been promoted. And I think in a more linear, stable world where the problems were almost constant, I think the solution space is where the differentiation or the innovation was. I think in a digital, ever reinventing world, the problem space is where the value creation will happen. Because all these new companies which are creating, you know, so much value, I think they thought of the problem in a very different way. And then, of course, solved it also uniquely. So to me, I think our people will win when they can, you know, better define that problem. And that can happen through some classical mean that we used in Six Sigma, just the five whys. Is that the problem? Someone tells you to your call center problem, I'll just ask the five whys and get to the root cause and realize that the problem that is worth solving is in the product space or somewhere else. And we are, you know, putting the, you know, cart before the horse. But there are other ways in which you can, I think, become better at it. And that's something that that I'm trying to, you know, I've always tried to inculcate in the team, is to say, if you have to be a better business partner, thought partner, helping define the right problem for them, that they can all, you know, look better. I mean, they are right now thinking on whatever is in front of them and trying to solve it. But your job is to help them define a bigger problem so that when that is solved, not just this gets eliminated, there are many other things which are getting solved. But how do you do that? For that, I think you have to develop your own ecosystem to get other ideas based on which you can do that. So let's say if you are a central team working in a function or in a certain domain, develop linkages with other people in other industries, other domains. So in our group, for example, we have such diversity. The retail fellow can talk to the finance fellow, to a commodity fellow, whatever. So develop that linkage on what problem are you solving, how are you doing it, and all of that. So that's one level of this thing. The second is, you know, we have many, you know, strategy teams and, you know, other teams in the group where we can say, hey, are you developing linkages with those strategy folks? Maybe they are doing something for the same businesses, which can give us some ideas. Why don't you talk to them? And there are, you know, other. So there are other ecosystems sometime within the company where you can develop linkages to say, what is the finance guy thinking? Finance guys are also looking at the lens of the business and trying to help them better. So can we form linkages with other, you know, enablers within the company or within the group is one. Second is go outside. In the ecosystem, there are peers. There are consulting firms. There are, you know, other new age entrant startups that have come about trying to solve. So I would think that I think it's very critical that we start developing those ecosystem linkages inside and outside, which can give us that, you know, creative ideas, which then we can bounce off with the business and they will see, oh, I didn't think of that. And I didn't think of that. And who gave you that idea? So they start respecting you for bringing some ideas in a thought provoking manner. And then, of course, once you have won that battle, then, you know, you can, you know, that's what I think if you think about it, fundamentally consulting firms do. They come and talk to you, they discuss with you, and they, you know, help you imagine a reality which you had not thought of. And once that problem has been defined, then so now you please solve it for me.
No, absolutely. And actually that's where, you know, understanding of the domain also becomes so important, right? Especially in an organization such as yours, you have so many businesses, which means you need to understand all the, you know, different verticals also to identify those problems. Interesting. Now, let's talk a little bit about data itself. Clean data is hard to get. Garbage in, garbage out, right? How does one go about ensuring that you have clean data? Because you won't know the data is dirty till you know the data is dirty. Any kind of guidance on that or guiding principles you can say? How does one look for problems in the data itself?
So I think that's a problem which is very hard to solve, because, you know, all of our IT systems, while we have always called them information technology, I don't think anyone ever used the information inside it. It remained just technology. So I keep saying that, you know, it was supposed to be called information technology. So that technology was supposed to give some information which was supposed to be used to drive decision. But looks like in the last so many decades, I don't know whether they have actually done that job. They were technologies for sure, but I don't think the information has been coming out cleanly, to your point. So that is true. I mean, I don't think there is any easy way to do that. But clearly these days what has happened is, with the newer tools that have come in, you know, so you can sometime, so for example, the one big problem people have is there are disparate systems. Oh, the sales system, and there's an order system, and there's a payment system, and they don't talk to each other. Nowadays, there are enough, you know, new tools that have come in, which will say, don't worry, you know, we can come and sit on top of all of those and pull data, and, you know, you can let those old fashioned system remain there, but we can connect the thing at the higher order level. So those types of tools are there, people are deploying them. So that's not a problem. I think the other is to say, as you start reimagining the future of the business and the business strategy, I think people have to start also thinking about the technology and the data strategy also. And that, I think you can't obviously change everything. But let's say, for example, you are a sales-driven company and that's your most important thing. Or let's say you are a customer service-driven company, to use your example. And that's the most critical advantage that you think. I think as you start inventing with the future, can you start thinking about what have been those data gaps, or what are some of those things that you can do in your system that allow you to create that advantage in the future? So while you may not have it now, but can you start working on it? So it's almost like saying, let's apply a band-aid and solve the, you know, the problem for now. But longer term, let's try to reinvent this thing in the way that it can be more holistic and from the inside. Because, you know, all these band-aids are good for something, but as you can imagine, you know, if these things are not designed for that purpose, they may still fail, may not be the most optimal. So I think it has to be the, you know, two strategies. One is the immediate. I have to do something now, which I can just, you know, do something. But then can I start thinking about what the future technology solution should be and start to solve for it? Otherwise, I'll still remain in the dinosaur era.
Yeah, but some of this, Pankaj, happens because of, you know, we use more and more kind of off-the-shelf SaaS products and so on. And many of the SaaS products which come across are kind of general products which work across horizontals, which means the depth is not necessarily there. And going there and figuring out some missing data is just so hard. How do you bring that into your strategy?
I have to say that, you know, this will again depend on case to case, because there are certain verticals or certain use cases where people have actually developed, products which have the domain knowledge, and people who are experts in that area, they have done that. I mean, I would say, I don't know whether NICE is a good example for the call center world or not, or or this, what is this other company? You know, I'm trying to remember this. Anyway, so there are these companies who have been designed by people who are experts in that field. We have in the banking area, there are, risk and fraud related products. So this is a design that people have done that. You know, so there are many very, specific bespoke products for certain use cases. Clearly, there isn't one which fits all. It's possible that your banking call center has a very different need from, let's say, a telecom call center or, some other, right? So those nuances will exist. But I think call center, I would have imagined, and I have not been close to it for a while, that there are products where people have thought through the customer service aspect, because this is a huge industry, and everyone and uncle always felt that they can automate it or do something about it. So I have over the years seen many products which are over there.
I think it's because of the, it's rapidly changing, right? Especially with digital, there are, multiple channels coming in. If you look at just voice, of course, it's existed for, so many years. So there's much depth which you've got. But others, there are several gaps. And when I see it from outside as a kind of a, person outside the system, I see that because it's been thought about as a horizontal, it needs to work for banks, it needs to work for retail, it needs to work for technical support in, technology companies. So it has left gaps in all of these. That's why I asked this question.
The company I was thinking of was Sprinklr, and I don't know whether it's a good example or not. I remember using that because they were trying to bring other channels also, not just the call center channel, but the digital channel and others, to say, how will we create an omni-channel understanding of the customer and help you with that? So I think, to your point, you're right. Things are evolving very fast, and many of these products start off as a horizontal, and over time, sometimes they develop, their expertise in certain verticals, and maybe that evolution is going on right now. But I have also seen at the same time some very specific products for a certain specific problem, especially in the banking space, where there are very high value problems which are worthy of such solutions.
Okay, cool. Once again, audience, if you have any questions, please post, because I have just a couple more questions for Pankaj. So just please post your questions in the Q&A box. So Pankaj, let's switch to privacy. I think there's a lot of kind of personal data, or rather data about people, right? Especially being used for tracking their consumer behavior and all that. And I think things are starting to tighten now. I see Apple, for instance, any app on Apple now, which will come out and ask, do you want this app to track what you're doing? And you say, no, it won't track. And I believe, if I remember right, I read recently, Facebook has actually come out with data saying that their ads on iPhones is dropped because of that feature. So, which means I would think, if I was to extend it, when more and more people get conscious of it, you're going to have less kind of personal data because of some of the privacy rules coming in. Do you see that changing to, the way in which data is being used in companies, especially, consumer facing companies?
Yeah, and that's a very interesting question. And this is something that I had once upon a time thought about and written an article on, and a lot of things have interestingly changed. So let me share with you what I thought. So I kind of argued that, this whole data privacy laws are very different. China was at that point in time different. They were allowing anyone to do anything. Europe was on the other extreme. They have very strong GDPR laws. And India was starting to think about IDPR, and California and the US had launched something and all of that, right? Fast forward, the biggest change has happened on the China front, interestingly, where I had said, hey, these guys, they can do anything. They will conquer the world with AI, because there is no rule and regulation. And they have actually interestingly gone in exactly the opposite direction in the last 6 months, if you're following what they're doing. And my is that the government probably somewhere realized that data is power or whatever. And they felt that the private sector having so much of power through data is probably not a good thing for the society, rightly or wrongly. The government, I think, can have it, but not the private sector. I think they probably look at them as a bit of a competitor, and they want to make sure that they are the big daddies and the private sector is subservient to that. So I think irrespective, I think that whole curtailment of the big tech firm because of the clout and the market value that they had created. And, we have seen their market value erode by 30 to 80%, depending on which company you look at in the last 6 months. So I think China has gone in the other direction than my own personal prediction, because I thought they will like leaps and bounds. I mean, they could do anything. That's the one thing. I think India has, I think, done a good thing with this whole Aadhaar stack, this four-layer stack, where that consent layer is also out there, which was, I think, pending for a while. I think we had the documentation layer and the identity layer and the payment layer, but the consent layer, I think, has also been launched. So I do think that the whole principle that your data is your data, it's like your money, you decide to give it to someone for a specific purpose. That's what I think. So I think, you know, now we have seen that the account aggregator, this thing has been also launched in India and all of that. So I think I'm very happy in the way the Indian technology stack, you know, Aadhaar enabled, all that, is allowing utilizing of data in the right way, and the technology is there. And I think people, the IDPR law and some of those things, I think, are also adhering to the principle that the data belongs to you. If someone has to use it, you know, they better take your consent. So I think we are going in the right direction. GDPR was anyway utilizing that principle, has gone that direction. I would think that the US and I would think that most of the democratic world will follow this principle. So I think it's China will probably be an exception, but my guess is that this is very hard. I mean, the US also, we have seen a lot of suits against the big tech on what they are doing, and you've seen that, and they are taking cognizance of that and changing this thing. So I would think that this whole unregulated utilization of data which was there is now slowly you know, going away. I think the US government also is, I think, cognizant of the fact, unlike the Chinese government, that they want to do it slowly and allow them time to make changes versus putting a strong regulation on the top and all of that, because that's how that country, they will allow the private sector some leeway to make changes on their own and improve their this thing, because they can see that what's coming. So I think that data eventually will become far less available, contrary to what it was going in the direction of in the past, and therefore companies will also have to figure out how to utilize that. Let's say a lot of people start to opt out of sharing data for various reasons. How will you make machine learning models? Or maybe you will make based on a biased sample of people who are willing to share data for business. So then your data or the model is relevant only for that category of people who have that characteristics and not for others. You know, so there are all kinds of these types of issues that will come up, especially on people where, they would say, okay, pump all the data in, which of course had its own biases, but now it'll have even more additional biases, which we will not know. We don't know who's opting out, what kind of data is out there, what kind of model to make, and what use is it for now. And I think the pandemic has also, changed a lot of behavior that some of us had. So I don't know whether, you and I are, will be using the same next buy model. Will we be buying the same things? We don't know. We were buying trousers. Now we're buying t-shirts and shorts, all of that. So I think the whole world of analysis and AI, a lot of these trends you rightly, alluded to are coming in, and we have to take cognizant of it and, make amends. I think we were going in a certain direction, the whole data privacy thing, the whole pandemic piece, and the consumers also becoming more aware of their rights are going to change the way we have been utilizing AI in the past. And I think that's fine. It's for the overall good for the society and benefit of the consumer in the long run, in my opinion.
Yeah, my question really is, are companies kind of concerned about it now? Are companies kind of thinking that far ahead in terms of, assuming that very little less personal data, because people are opting out, do I need to think of something else or some other way of doing my business? Are companies kind of, getting concerned about it?
Yeah, I think the big concern that a lot of companies have had right now is the bias in the model and the data, and unfettered use of AI, which will cause some loss or mistake. So clearly banks will be most for it, because banks tend to lose a lot of money if they make mistakes. But even big tech companies, Microsoft, Google, Amazon, all of that, they're also they are putting governance mechanism on use of AI and model. So they are trying to put central principles based on which you can do that. So in the past, I think some of these were pretty federated and deregulated, and any department or any individual could use data and do what they had to do. I think there's a lot of focus on centralized regulation in these large tech companies to make sure that the law is being followed, the biases are not creeping in, and people are doing it in a better way. So I think I would say right now there's a bit of risk avoidance focus, if I can say so, versus saying where is that huge opportunity, because I think chasing those opportunities, we went too far ahead. I think we are trying to step back and say, before chasing the next opportunity, let's put the right infrastructure in place so that we don't make a mistake.
Yeah, and also related to that, kind of, do you think explainability will become important? For instance, you run these models, it comes out with a certain result, only that model knows how it came out with the result. So especially in insurance and so on, when you're going to deny somebody a certain policy, will you be able to explain it? Is that one of the concerns, you know, coming in as well when one looks at using AI like models?
Yeah. So explainability is there in many situations. Clearly, like you said, in the banking or the regulated space, where people want to know the answer, and you can be sued if you didn't know that. But I look at the analogy of technical analysis and fundamental analysis in stock markets. Both approaches seem to work. There are people who will say, "I'm just doing momentum trading, and I have seen this pattern, and when this happened, then this happened, and it works for me." So I would think that the same thing will probably apply here, that there'll be certain cases, momentum trading being one example, that I don't care. This strategy seems to work. I make money. Why do I have to explain it to anyone? Money making is the right explanation. And therefore, there would be certain situations where if the desired outcome is coming through that black box model, you frankly don't care, because no one is asking for the explanation. It's working. And I may not be the best example, but let's say in your call center, someone is, tagging the call, which is the bad call, and the manager picks up and reduces the escalation. And over time, you see that this AI model is always finding the call which needs escalation. Then you don't care how it's found out, because your escalation is going down. Your people are happy. Your customers are happy. I'm just taking an example.
Momentum
versus fundamental, or the technical versus fundamental, is the way it has always been. It was always there in financial services. No one asked for an explanation of a technical analysis. Same, I think, idea, I would say, will apply in this area. It's no different.
Okay. So, Pankaj, we have a question from the audience. Let me just quickly read it. I have a very basic question, and you may have touched upon it. Sorry if I missed it. There's a lot of hype around the term data science. How does one differentiate between data scientist, data science engineer, and data analyst? I think you kind of talked about it right at the beginning.
But I can say that again, that I always see that if I were to answer this question, what will you do with it? So that's the thing, that when the business says, "Oh, I can you answer this question?" And I say, "Okay, first tell me, what will you do with it? How will it create a difference in your life?" And then maybe I have a better understanding of why I have to answer that question. So I don't typically get into this taxonomy definition, because frankly, I have no idea. If I gave you this definition for all three of them, what are you going to do with it? So to me, some of these taxonomies are a bit irrelevant, because they are different people are using it for different purposes. But clearly, this world of data science has very distinct skill sets required. So for example, statistical modeling is a skill set, right? Understanding data engineering is a skill set. ML ops, so there are skill sets. So I would say, if you are someone who's trying to make a career in this field, forget about what that data science and all of this is. Look at the capability and the skill set. Try to see what all you can acquire. I mean, I would say, if you are a super person, acquire all of them so that you can be that individual who knows it all. But not then, like I said, in my mind, there are two types of people who are closer to customer, closer to technology. So if you're closer to technology, get as much as you can in that area and become the expert in that area. So I think if making a career or getting expertise is the question, I think that definition will probably not help you answer that question. I think something else. So that's why, like I said.
Yeah. So I'm going to repeat some of the stuff which you said, especially if somebody is aspiring to kind of get into data science. You said statistical modeling is an important skill to have. I think you mentioned two others.
Data engineering, because like you said, how to get the right data from the right sources, put it in the right place. And things like that. And then, think about, technology as the whole stack. So you have, let's say, the infrastructure at the base layer, there could be cloud platform, there could be other tools, there could be application, there would be data and all of that. So I think, so you have to decide, are you closer to the technology or are you closer to the business? And then you can start going in the other direction so that you can get as much appreciation of the other, so that you can solve the problem in a more seamless fashion than a disjointed fashion. So
yeah, great. Okay. I'm going to finish with one last question for you, Pankaj. How much data do you use to improve your timings for marathons?
None. In fact, I...
By the way, just to let everybody know, Pankaj is an avid marathoner. How many have you done, Pankaj, so far? Full marathons? At least 50?
Must have been. So like I said, I didn't count that, because that number would not have changed anything in my life. So I just don't. So in fact, I once upon a time, I gave a talk on, how much will I pay for AI, or you could say, how much will I pay for data? And after all of that, I said, frankly, nothing, because most of my decisions in life do not actually require any data. Most of them are, you know, coming from my own intuition or my own belief. And most of the other tactical decisions have just been automated. You know, what do I wear in the morning, blue or a white shirt? I don't need any data. Or what do I do? So I think it depends on, you know, what your situation is and how much data do you need. I actually don't need most of the data, because most of the thing that I do is out of my interest, out of my passion. And I don't need any data to support that. So my running marathon, I don't know how many I've done, what was my timing was. If I do a Google search, I will find, you know, I probably know my best timing, but that's about it. I'm there for the social conversation, as you know, the run-versation. The versation is more important than the run.
So are you still doing your Saturday runs now?
Yeah, Saturday runs, Sunday cycling. These days, sometimes Tuesday, Thursday, short runs also nearby. The pandemic has made us more local. So we have developed some local routes also, and some flexibility was there. So I could do that. So yeah, so those things continue, and all in a social environment.
Lovely. Pankaj, that was a fantastic conversation. Thank you so much for all your insights. And I want to thank Freshworks as well for supporting this event. So with that, let me hand over to Renil. Renil, all yours.
Thank you. Thanks, MD. Thanks, Pankaj. That is a very insightful conversation. Hope to have more of such coming forward as well. All right. Thanks for the audience for joining in on a Thursday evening and taking the time out to hear a conversation from CCOF. We look forward to seeing you on our next session. Once again, thank you, MD and Pankaj, for joining in.
Thank you all.
Lovely.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.
Thanks.